We should just repost.
You're on mute, Rox.
Let's try this again. Sorry about that. Thank you. Welcome back, everyone. Cohen Hubritz is the 3D Systems team lead for Aerospace Applications Development Metal CIC. Cohen's topic for our DAM conference is aerospace metal applications. Form follows function, cooperation cuts costs. Cohen holds a master's in industrial sciences from the International University College Group T of KU Leuven. He proceeded as postgraduate on entrepreneurial engineering experience at the same faculty, during which time he worked as a team member, mechanical engineer, and business developer of the Formula Group T and CQS Group T Racing Team in Leuven. At 3D Systems, he started as an application engineer, guiding customers through the field of metal AM. Now, 6 years later, at the Customer Innovation Center in Belgium, he manages a team of engineers who support customers to develop and manufacture metal AM aerospace components. Welcome, Cohen.
Thank you, Roxanne. Let me see if I can share full screen. Is that still visible for everyone?
Looks great, Cohen.
Okay, then I'll kick off. So today I will present mainly three different space applications. So a lot of technical content, and also the second chapter on costs. We'll not talk about euros or dollars, but about technical innovations and some failures as well for illustration, how we can do a better job in the future. Let me start by quoting the young me. So this statement opens our lightweighting ebook, which you can find also on the website of 3D Systems. And I dislike focusing on specific added values. That's why my presentation will always start from the function and end with a list of all incremental or even disruptive improvements. Cost, lead time, weight, flowing performance, you can name it. You should always think of additive manufacturing as if it was a new toolbox to make new geometries possible. And again, like any other manufacturing method, both with its advantages and also disadvantages. From the moment your manager approves the high cost of using metal AM, I advise you to be greedy and take as much advantages as possible. Let's find out together based on a couple of space applications. And these are the applications or families of applications my team works on the most during their daily activities. You can subdivide them into structural components, mainly brackets in titanium, typically radio frequency applications and propulsion hardware. So the couple of them we will discuss. Others like the one from the University of Madrid, that's a very accurate radio frequency feed system, a quadruple antenna in titanium but coated with silver for higher conductivity. Now, to start off with the radio frequency filter from Airbus Defence and Space. So this is a world premiere that we developed already a couple of years ago. As you see, it's launched 2017. The innovation lies on the inside of the part, nothing to see on the outside, where in the lower picture you can see the radio frequency element printed in aluminium silicium 10 laser form material, and on the top side you see the conventionally produced part. Important to mention here as well is that the project was an outcome of one of the ESA projects that the Customer Innovation Center participated to. So what you understand the function of it, it's hardly any difficulty with it. So it's a special field of application, let's say radio frequency, but it's just a hardware passive component that manipulates a radio frequency signal on a radio communication satellite. The form is typically predefined by the conventional production techniques, which are capable of manufacturing the inside geometries. And typical manufacturing techniques include spark erosion, milling, and for some elements also turning. Now, as I mentioned in the title of the presentation, what we want to focus on is the function of the part. And that's when we look at the internal geometry of the functional usage of the part. So it's the electrical signal travels across the surfaces of the inside of the part. So you actually only need a couple of tens of micrometers of material thickness for that. All the rest is ballast, let's say. But what we want to achieve is that we, together with Airbus, we optimize the cavity geometries so that the form one-on-one follows the function, let's say. And one of the technical aspects which were really important to convince the RF design engineers is about the roughness. And so the electrical signal travels across the surface. But as you know, metal AM produces relatively rough surfaces compared to conventionally produced parts. But if we then look at the direct metal printing technology and we look at the function, which is solely electrical conductivity, then we see that we have a much more gradual roughness or topology, I must say, compared to, for instance, milled surfaces. So that means that although the RA value that you could measure can be same or even higher, your electrical resistivity values are lower compared to the same RA value in conventionally produced elements. Still bear in mind that also mature post-processes are readily available, and that it's also important to keep that in mind during your design for additive manufacturing. And one of the typical post-processing applications we used here was to coat this filter with an electrical electrolytic silver plating process, which decreased the resistivity. So this then became the first radio frequency filter on a geocommunication satellite. On the left side, you see the complete manufacturing process where actually not any exotic design software was used, but just the default RF design software. The thing that we innovated was to fill the library with new geometries, which enable the engineer to design new filter cavities, let's say. And then it also withstand all qualification activities for a first off, so first time that such a metal printed part was mounted on a geocommunication satellite and launched to space. If you want to know more about aerospace qualification and validation aspects, there's a webinar that will be presented by my colleague Jeff Rupert on May 5th, which you can find also on our website. And so this was the final result. Without optimizing for mass, we already achieved 50% weight reduction because we could avoid the assembly because it's a monolithic part and we could print the internal cavities. There was no need to manufacture two halves and assemble those parts with quite some heavy bolts if you compare to the overall mass of 60 grams that we achieved compared to the initial target of 120 grams. So the next application I want to speak about is propulsion related. So in a Horizon 2020 project, together with the German Aerospace Center, DLR, and also more than a dozen other partners, we anticipated to the SMILE project, which stands for Small Innovative Launcher. The goal there was to have a two-stage or three-stage small launcher for dedicated small payloads. And one of the objectives was to increase TRL levels, TR level, let's say, of critical technologies. Focus for the Customer Innovation Center in Belgium of 3D Systems and mainly the German Aerospace Center was on a new innovative rocket engine, where DLR focused on the CMCs, and then the injector design and production was meant to be printed in laser form nickel 718. So it was also hot fire tested to raise the technology readiness level to 6. Now again, let's see at what the functions are of such an injector head. So some general ones and also purely functional ones. Important overall is that a liquid propellant injector head combines several functions and thereby also combines different fields of applications. And that means that in your design phase, both mechanics, flow dynamics, material knowledge, etc., has to be combined and handled simultaneously. To give you a first picture on the inside then, the form after mentioning the functions. You have two large cavities, and you can also see the dome sphere design on the blue cavity. So that's the liquid oxygen volume. The orange one is the fuel volume then. And then we were also able to integrate two different small features, let's say. One is a film cooling feed line. So that's a continuous layer of additional kerosene. And then transpiration cooling feed line, as you could see in the previous picture, that pushes some more kerosene through the walls. And because the CMC is semi-permeable, it cools the whole wall of the combustion chamber for higher efficiency. And this is another picture and becoming more complex now. But what is also interesting to mention here is that without any additional cost, we were able to integrate sensor channels very accurately to the place where we want to measure pressure drops and also temperature. And then instead of using the alliteration form follows function, here you see the fire follows the kerosene flow and the LOX flow. And so this is the test setup tested in Spain at PLD space. First, some liquid oxygen cold test on the left side and then in the middle after ignition. Then a third application that focuses then more on structural elements, typically made in titanium, which is a very nice material to process on our Flex 350 machine. So there we always stress the partnership with Thales Alenia Space. So by now we have more than 1,500 flight parts delivered and more than 1,000 already in space on different geocommunication missions. And so for Thales, throughout the years, we produced all these parts according our validated process flow. So that means that those elements are printed on an IQOQ PQ controlled machine. We always deliver with a certificate of conformance, with a material and heat treatment certificate, an inspection report, which is fully tailored to the needs of each application. And then typically for non-machine parts, as you can see on the picture, some Strutent fittings. We only deliver optical scan data, but for some other applications, CMM measurements are done on the critical interfaces. Tensile test results for each job can also be expanded to chemical tests, and everything according to our AS9100 certified methodology. So to give you an illustration of where such parts end up. So it's a geocommunication satellite, typically a couple of tons of weight and a couple of meters in dimension. And so this one was the first one to carry our first topology optimized brackets on the reflector, as you can see on the right hand picture, during one of its final ground tests. Now again, the function, and actually that's not too difficult for this one. It's a so-called hold and release component, as you can see in the Ariane 5 render on the upper right side. A lot of the 780 tons of rocket is fuel. And you might know that around 400 tons of fuel is burned during the first 2 minutes of a mission. So 780 tons of mass on Earth, and that typically finishes with only 10 ton reaching an orbit. So at the upper top side, below the fairing, there's place for one or two satellites, and everything has to be folded quite compact together, and that's where the function of the V-fitting comes in. So it holds the reflector against the bus, the chassis of the satellite, let's say, and then once in orbit, it releases, so the reflector can deploy. Now, something you might not know, and if you look again at this picture, you might see in the reflection of the light that such a very expensive reflector seems all bruised. Now, of course, that's on purpose, because satellites have many transponders and different frequency bands. They require multiple reflectors, and because power on a satellite is very you don't have a lot of power, let's say, so you want to be efficient with it. So every reflector is uniquely shaped. And so Telkom 3S, somewhere sitting 35,000 kilometers above the equator, constantly hangs above Indonesia or Southeast Asia. And since that position is constant, the reflector is formed in such a way that no signal power is wasted on non-populated areas or oceans. But that also means for us that each fitting is unique. Yeah? So the geometry looks the same, but I think we made around 40 of these brackets until today. And they all have unique interface locations. And so to understand that function, and I will not talk about too much about topology optimization, but it's important to already give you an understanding of the second half of this presentation about cooperation, where we developed a way of working together with our CNC supplier on how to reuse tooling, and the alignment strategy to not waste time. And you should not underestimate alignment time compared to the actual milling time for such a topologically optimized printed parts. So thereby we came up with a methodology to save time on that process. There's one quote that in these times cannot emphasize more how important cooperation is, manus manum lavat, and how that can lead to saving costs. So the following three slides I'll use to stress the function and the mission of the Customer Innovation Center. So basically, we want to accelerate the development of products on their commercialization trajectory for our customers while being made additively in metal, of course. And one of the strengths of our team is that we use the technology we develop in-house day by day for different markets. So besides aerospace, that's also healthcare and other high-tech markets. And we can directly provide feedback to our R&D colleagues that besides developing the machines and the process, also develop heat treatments, and the materials themselves. So on the left side, you can see our products, let's say. Application development, that's where I sit in. We have two kinds of engineering services, both focused on training and product, as well as on process and validation activities. And then a third product, let's say, is training our customers on all kinds of topics. The organization is split in six teams of each time multiple engineers. And then besides the CIC in Leuven, we also have a mirror site in Denver, Colorado. And so what is important for us is to cooperate together with subsidizing entities for aerospace. That's something you might have noticed. So multiple of those applications are developed with some help from local or international government organizations. Especially these days and the coming period, that might be helpful to take you up to the ladder. These are the four phases we defined, which we find critical to understand where you are with your knowledge and expertise and how we can help or tap into that. The bold domains are the ones that where application engineers are active in. So I spoke about radio frequency filters, very nice one-on-one part replacement. But if you look at the whole satellite layout nowadays, very high throughput satellites with more than 1,000 radio frequency elements, what I want to stress always is to focus on system design rather than on part substitution. And so we want to stimulate cooperation between parts. In the first place, the higher the system impact can be, the higher the innovation is. And if you look at the results of another ESA study we performed together with OHB, you can see that a reduction in waveguide losses translates or has overspills to all other kinds of domains which are interesting, and in the end also reduce the amount of propellant mass needed and thereby even enabling new communication concepts. And so together with Airbus, we're now developing not just RF parts, but we're looking at RF systems where we integrate different radio frequency channel functionalities into monolithic designs. You can then think of function integration, like also adding mechanical fixtures, thermal management, always important in space. And by combining parts into monolithic designs, we have a tremendous impact on the lead time and the assembly and intermediate quality costs. So again, imagine how long it takes to assemble this network of waveguides and tubes. That takes months in the assembly time for the satellite. And that is the level where we want to innovate together with you. On the injector again, I promised some failures as well, so here they are. So during one of the 9 iterations throughout that 3-year project, we found out about a couple of issues. One was in position A, too high thermal stresses. So this was quite a bulky part as it was not yet optimized for lightweight applications, for the ground tests only. So during the printing, one of the support structures came loose underneath one of the 4 large interfaces, and that created a layer defect in position A. Although it seems to be recovered, there's still a root cause for leakage. And also in position B, where we typically advise customers to add fillets to reduce thermal stresses in local areas. And so sharp edges always create stress concentrations. This one was missed, and a very fine burr seems to be present all around the part, and thereby causing again some leakage. Now, cooperation which I want to highlight here is one with Amphion of Edited Works, which is now integrated in 3D Expert, and it allows you to simulate the building process. Another defect that you still nowadays cannot simulate is when a bolt cracks because of the thermal stresses in your base plate itself. So these are still the daily adventures we have to face. And then coming to an end of this presentation, also in the propulsion field of application, I want to stress the cooperation with GF Precicast now, company that has decades of experience in also the post-processing of propulsion-like elements. And so with our new Factory 500 machine, we can offer very large propulsion-related and other parts from Switzerland. And also within our dear Flex 350 machine, we find cooperation, which we could add recently. So together with Thales Alenia Space, we're fine-tuning this on a very extensive program, where we now still have to make a CT scan of each individual part for their primary structures, which we manufacture. So we have a bunch of sensors implemented, both visual as photodiodic based, where we can detect all porosities larger than 200 micrometers, and you can find the scientific paper on our website. But this is a very nice addition to the technology.
Hi, Cohen. This is Roxanne. Yeah. I'm sorry to interrupt, but we are running very, very tight on time. So
I understand.
Just a couple more seconds, if you don't mind.
Yep, that's fine. And this is actually one of the last slides. So all what I summed up nicely integrates in how we develop applications today. So this is a full workflow based on our 3D Expert software, which we can offer all the way up to a final part. And then the very last slide is where I always question my team on what are the things that you want your customers to remember. And then these are the outcomes of that short frustration conversation, let's say. So we want to focus on the design. Manufacturing is not the only innovation. The more you understand the manufacturing technique, the more benefits you can take of it. But that has to be built into your design. And so both technical and commercial know-how on that process are important to make the right decisions. And that's where we want to help. And also to stress that topology optimization is not always the same as optimized for AM. As you can see on the right-hand side, it's very difficult to remove all support structures on the internal geometry. want to offer our help to develop those applications together with you. So that was it. Here are my contact details and the link to the case studies I presented. I leave it to Rixen again.
Perfect. Thanks, Cohen. We do have a couple questions that we'll forward to you, Cohen, after this so that you can reply back. And for everybody still on, 3D Systems does have a table in our virtual networking session. So please feel free to look Cohen and the rest of the 3D Systems team up, and they'll be happy to talk to you a little bit more about what they're doing right here. So thank you, Cohen, and thank you, everyone, for taking the time for this presentation.